Hi there. In this second video on the fundamental subspaces of a matrix, we're going to look at the column space. Remember, the first video was on the null space, and please go and watch that video. I'll link it in the description down below, and there'll be a card up here. If you're watching on a computer, you'll see that card. So have a look at that video first. We're going to use sort of the similar code. I will review a little bit about the null space, but best you view that video first. Now we're going to use Jupyter Notebook again, and that's inside our Visual Studio Code, as you can see here. And we're going to use the sympy library. First of all, at the top, you'll see Mathematics, Python 3.9.2. So I do create special environments, Python environments using Conda for all of my work. And so that's just for you to see in the top right-hand corner there. If you want to set up your system in a similar way, that would be Python 3.9.2. So let's set up those packages. I'm going to use sympy once again, and I import sympy without any abbreviations there. So it's just import sympy. And that means if I want to use one of the functions inside of sympy, I have to type out the whole word sympy dot. So just for your interest as well, you can see I'm using the dunder attribute version there. So 1.10.1 as far as sympy is concerned, and then we want this LaTeX to be printed to the screen. Nice mathematical notation. So I'm going to call the init underscore printing function inside of NumPy. So let's just think about, to start off by thinking about a vector in Rn. So we're talking about mostly here about the geometric interpretation of a vector, but we can also just think of it as an array of numbers. Whichever way you want to look at it, Rn can be a representation of one of, or each of, least of the columns, column vectors, we would call them, in a matrix. So if we look at our matrix in equation 1 here, I have a column vector 1, 2, 5, a column vector 3, 3, 1, and a column vector 1, 2, 2. So if you think about it, each one of those, geometrically at least, will exist in 3 space. And that really has to do with the way that we set this matrix up, in as much as there are only 3 rows. So if we talk about an M by N matrix, as you can see there, we know that the result, which is B, if you think about AX equals B, as we see there, we'll term X the solution always, and B we term the result. So we have a result that is an element of Rm, purely because there are three elements in each of these column vectors. There are 3 rows in my matrix. So critically, we really need to think of multiplying A by some vector X. And because we have a square matrix here, X will also be an element of R3. But it is this linear combination of these column vectors. So it's X sub 1 times the first column vector, X sub 2 times the second column vector, X sub 3 times the third column vector. And that's going to give us the result for some solution X. And X in our instance, as I said, because it is a square matrix, there are 3 columns, it'll also be an element of R3. Now, what we have to think about here before we get there is to think this vector B, the result vector, what values can it take? If we think about all of 3 space, because our example here is really just 3 space, what areas in that geometrical space can this result vector B take? That is what we want to determine. So a little bit of a revisit of the null space. We're going to create a matrix here, and as you can see, I'm again using the sympy.matrix function. I'm passing a Python list, and then I'm using the reshape, so dot reshape method, and I want that to be reshaped as a 3x3 matrix. So that's one way to go about it. And you can see we have assigned to the computer variable A, we've assigned this matrix that we had in equation 1. So you can see the column vectors there, 1, 2, 5, 3, 3, 1, 1, 2, 2. Now, this is a matrix in which these 3 column vectors are linearly independent. Not one of them is a linear combination of the other. So the addition of constant multiples of one of the other ones, and we can look at that as far as the rank is concerned to confirm that. So we can use in sympy here the rank method. So a.rank, we see a rank of 3. That means there are 3 linearly independent columns, or in a mathematical textbook, that might be there are 3 pivots. Now, we can set up also a homogeneous system. So we'll have a result as a zero vector and see if the solution to x is a zero vector. If that is so, that means that's the only solution that will give us a zero vector as a result. And we know that there's linear independence. We also remember the fact that we have that the rank plus the nullity must equal the number of columns. And we have a rank of 3. We have 3 column vectors. Therefore, we're never going to have a basis vector or more than one basis vector. We're not going to have any basis vector when it comes to the null space. And if we call the null space method there on our matrix A, we see we get back this empty Python empty list. And that means we don't have a vector that spans any space. So the null space does not exist. Although remember, we will always have the zero vector there. It's just that the zero vector does not span any space. So let's then dive into this column space. Remember, we said that it is the result B that we after. What values can B take? So we're thinking of 3 space. Can it be any vector in 3 space? Or is it constrained to some plane or even some line? And so what we're going to call here just on A is the column space. So very fortunately, we have this idea, at least a method called the column space in sympy. And you can see it's just going to return these 3 column vectors for me as is. They're linearly independent. In other words, they are a basis for the whole of R3. There are 3 of them, which is what I would require as a set of basis vectors to span the whole space. And they are one version of basis vectors. You can, of course, this is 3 space, so it can even have the 3 standard basis vectors that will also span R3. And that's something I think that we just have to talk about a little bit. And that is this idea of if we do elementary row operations on our matrix, is that going to affect the column space? So the end result of elementary row operations with Gauss-Jordan elimination would be the reduced row echelon form. So that's as kind of as many elementary row operations as you could perform. So let's do that. We've seen the RREF, row reduced echelon form method. So I'm going to call that on A. And that's going to return 2 things for me, the reduced row echelon form of our matrix. And it's also going to return, well, that's a tuple that it returns. The first element in that tuple, or the zeroth element, would be the reduced row echelon form matrix. But the second element in that tuple is going to be a tuple itself. And that's a tuple of the indices, the column indices that contain the pivots. And that's not what I want. So I'm going to use indexing. And I just want the zeroth element in that tuple that gets returned, so that I only get the reduced row echelon form of the matrix. And I'm going to assign that to a variable called A underscore RREF. And as you can see there, as we suspected, that we are going to get back the identity matrix. That's a square matrix. We have linearly independent matrix. All the 3 columns are linearly independent. If we do Gauss-Jordan elimination, we are going to end up with the identity matrix. And that is exactly what we do get. Now let's have a look at the basis vectors for the column space of this matrix that has now undergone elementary row or at least elementary row operations were performed on this. And what we get back are these 3 standard basis vectors. And of course, they span R3. And that would be a different set of vectors that are the basis as opposed to the 3 that we had before. So in our instance, it does not change the space that is spanned. But this is a very special case. So I want you to remember, very important here, that elementary row operations, they are going to affect the column space. They're going to give you a different column space once you do any kind of elementary row operations. So as before with a null space, we're going to go through all the kinds of matrices that you might come across. So our second one here is going to be a square matrix, but now we have we don't have linear independence. So I've created this third column, which is just the addition of the first 2 column vectors. So definitely we have linear dependence here. Any one of these column vectors can be written in terms of the other 2. So if I do the rank, I better get back a rank of 2. And indeed, we have a 2 there. Now, this has consequence for us. Remember that I have 3 columns. I have a rank of 2, which means I must have a nullity of 1. So there's going to be a vector that's a basis of the null space. But what does that do for our column space? Well, we can no longer have a basis that will span all of R3. We're only going to get back two, and what this column space is going to do, again, it's going to return the first two of two column vectors that are linearly independent of each other. And the first two that it found was the first one and the second one, or the zeroth one and the first one when it comes to Python indices. And you can see them there, 1, 2, 1 and 2, 4, 1. And if you think about those two vectors in 3-space, they will span only a plane through the origin. And that plane, I want to use an inverted commas, it's sort of an angled plane. It's not on the XY or YZ or XZ planes. It's sort of angled. And any solution vector X, if I take this matrix and multiply it by any solution vector that I can think of, which is a vector X, I cannot get to all of 3-space. There is a constraint now placed upon the possible result vectors, and that is the column space. My B, vector B, is now constrained, and that constraint is the column space. And the two vectors that we see there are a basis for those. Now, what if I were to do the column space on the row reduced echelon form? So now I've performed elementary row operations on A, and you can see the A.RREF, the RREF method, but I use the zeroth index of that because I only want back the matrix and not the tuple of pivots, and then call the column space on this. So this is me looking at the effect of elementary row operations on my matrix. Does that change the column space? And yes, look at that. I have, again, two vectors. They are now the basis of the column space of this new row reduced echelon form of this matrix. And we can see there, the first vector is in 3-space and it points along the x-axis, if you think geometrically. The second one points along the y-axis. So any linear combination of them has to be a vector in the xy plane. But we've just said that these two vectors here that are a basis for the column space of the original matrix A, that's going to be slightly angled. It's on this angled plane through the origin in 3-space. So these are not the same subspaces. They are different subspaces. So please remember that if you do elementary row operations on a matrix, you very likely are going to change the column space, because it's very rare that we deal with a square matrix that is totally linearly independent. We're going to deal with matrices in most cases that have many more rows than columns, that be sort of quite normal, and we are going to affect the column space, so don't make that mistake. Elementary row operations do not affect the null space or the row space, and the next video tutorial is going to be about the row space. It does not affect those subspaces, but it does affect the column space. It's only in that very neat example of a linearly independent square matrix that we're not going to change the column space, but in other instances, be on the watch out for changing that column space. Because what the problem is, and I think what the crucial bit is that you sort of have to realize is this, is the following. So let me take a matrix. I'm just going to create a solution matrix X there, 2, 2, 1. There we go. Now I can use the sympy.matmul. So that's matrix multiplication of matrix A and the solution vector X. So I'm doing AX and I'm going to get back some B. Now, if I just were to just do that, it's just going to neatly print that A and X to the screen for me. So I've got to do the dot do it method there, and that's going to do the actual calculation for me. And I get this vector B, this result vector, 9, 18, 6. So what I did is I took 2 times column vector 1 of A plus 2 times column vector, second column vector of A, plus 1 times the third column vector of A. That is what AX means. So I've done that for you here in print in equation 3. So it's 2 times the first column vector plus 2 times the second column vector plus 1 times the third column vector. We do remember, though, when we set up this, that this third column vector was just the addition of the first two. So I can, this 3, 6, 2, I can rewrite that, and that's what we see on the second line as 1 times 1 to 1 and 1 times 2, 4, 1. It's just the addition of those two. If you were to look at that, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 4 is 6, and 1 plus 1 is 2, so nothing changes. But these two column vectors, they're the same as the first two column vectors. So I've got twice this column vector plus 1 that column vector. That gives me 3 times the first column vector, 2 times the second column vector plus 1 times the second column vector. That gives me 3 times the second column vector, and then there's nothing left, 0 left. of that. And this means I have a new vector. Look at this, 3, 3, 0. That's a different solution vector than the first one. Our first one was 2 to 1. Now we have a separate one, 3, 3, 0. But look what happens if I do this, taking matrix A and multiplying it by this solution vector. I get back the exact same B. So there are more than one solution vectors that, you know, when it's acted upon by my matrix, so A times X gives me the same B. There was some constraint on B in this instance. And now you can clearly see why we won't have an inverse for this matrix. Because I can't go back from B to A because there are two solution vectors that we've seen here, two different solution vectors X that get, we'll use those terms in a different lecture when we talk about, or a different way to look at the multiplication of matrix A with a vector X, that linear transformation of X. There are two of these column vectors, or two of these solution vectors, they get this translation to the exact same vector. We don't have all of 3 space available to us now. It's constrained to the subspace that is this plane through the origin. And clearly two different solution vectors, X, they get translated to this very same vector, 9, 18, 6. I hope you can see that that is that constraint. And hence, this is not one-to-one and onto this linear transformation as far as a function is concerned. And therefore, it's not a bijection and it won't have an inverse. I can't get back because here we've shown at least there are two ways to get back, or there are two different vectors to get back to if I tried to take the inverse of A. And we will not have an inverse of A. It's impossible to calculate an inverse of A. So that's sort of the nice part of understanding this idea of a column space. So let's move on. We're going to talk about rectangular matrices with more columns than rows. Now, we saw what happened there before. If we look at this first matrix, sympy matrix object that we create, 3x4 matrix, as you can see there by the reshape. I have 12 elements here in my Python list. I reshape them in 3 rows and 4 columns, and we see that. So each of my column vectors, think about it, they exist in R3, in 3 space. I need 3 basis vectors. So of 3 of these, I only need 3 of them to be linearly independent. I have 4. So there's no ways that at least one of them is not going to be a linear combination of the other. That should just be logical. So if I look at the rank, now I've created this such that 3 of them are linearly independent. My rank is going to be 3. So again, in this semi-special case, I'm still going to span all of R3. But I now have 4 column vectors, and I can express any one of them as a linear combination of the others. I have 4 columns though, and I have a rank of 3, which means I must have a nullity of 1. There must be a basis vector in the null space. And that is true. First of all, let's just look at the column space, and we can see it's going to return just the first 3 linearly independent columns that it can find, and it is those first 3, 1 to 1, 2, 4, 1, 1, 3, 7. The third one there at least. So you can see what happened here. So look at this third one. It's 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 4 is 6, 1 plus 1 is 2. So the second one was, you know, looked at the first one, then looks at the second one and says, well, it's not a linear combination of the first one. Looks at the third one and says, oh, well, that is a linear combination of the first two. So it's going to skip that one. And then the third one finds, well, it's not a linear combination of those 3 that came before. So it's returning those 3 that are linearly independent. And that is the basis for all of R3. So again, I can span all of R3, but I've got 4 columns, so a nullity of 1. So there must be a vector that exists, that at least is a basis for my null space. Look at that though, that this solution vector X that is a basis for the null space is an element of R4, not R3 anymore. So that null space, when we have this kind of matrix shape, is not necessarily then going to be in the same or part of the same vector space as those column vectors. Now let's have a look at taking this matrix X, and there we go, that was the basis vector, and let's say 3 times that vector, which is now a different vector, minus 3, minus 3, minus 3. If I were to multiply this new 3 times X by A, it's still going to give me 0, 0, 0. And that's what we mean, it is a basis. Any scalar multiple of that, and if there was more than one, a linear combination of those basis vectors for the null space. If I were to take matrix A and multiply it by any one of those vectors in that subspace, it's always going to result in a result vector that is B. So that should be quite clear. Once again, let's do elementary row operations here and then call the column space. And we see that those are the standard basis vectors of R3. So this is once again a special case. I did already span all of R3 by my column vectors, in as much as at least three of them were linearly independent. The fourth one, absolutely, whichever one of the four it is, must be a linear combination of the others. But I'm still talking about the same column space. It's still R3. But once again, it's not always so. So watch out. Elementary row operations, most definitely, most of the time, is going to give you a different column space. Now we get to matrices that we'll see much more commonly. We have many more rows than we have columns. So in our first instance, we create a sympy matrix object, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rows and 3 columns. And that means that each of these column vectors are an element of R5. And if we look at the rank, we see that it's 3. So these are linearly independent column vectors. Now let's call the column space of that. And what we're going to find, once again, it's going to return the first, or at least all the first linearly independent column vectors that are confined. We have a rank of 3, we only have 3 columns, so all 3 of those vectors. Now each of those vectors are an element of R5, but I've only got 3 of them, so that is a basis for a subspace of R5. I cannot span all of R5. Now let's have a look at what happens when we do elementary row operations on this matrix. And as I said, the most extreme form of that is to use Gauss-Jordan elimination until we get the reduced row echelon form. Now look clearly at the difference between these 3. These are not the same column space. This is 3 basis vectors and another 3 basis vectors, and they do not span the same subspace of R5. Because look at this, if I look at x4 and x5, they're non-zero in these first 3, but here we're looking at standard basis vectors, and there's no way for me to have any element in x4 and x5. They are, you know, all zero. So these, you should clearly see that these are two different column spaces. Two very different column spaces. So do not do any elementary row operations on your matrix before you look at the column space of that matrix. So now let's look at a rectangular matrix, again with more rows than columns, and now we have linear dependence. So let's have a look at this one. And you can see 1 plus 2 is 3, 1 plus 3 is 4, 1 plus 5 is 6, 2 plus 2 is 4, 2 plus 4 is 6. So clearly we have linear dependence here. And if we look at the rank, now those first 2 are linearly independent. So the rank is going to be 2. I am definitely going to have a matrix in the null space. But let's have a look at the column space here. Once again, returns for me the first linearly independent vectors that it finds. And now we can see there's only 2. So my subspace is now even more constrained. As far as R5 is concerned, I only have these 2 basis vectors. Once again, let's do the reduced row echelon form. Take the column space of that. Once again, look at this. x3, x4, and x5. There's no way that a linear combination of these 2 basis vectors is going to get anywhere in, you know, with an x3, x4, x5. In R5, they're never going to be values there, but I do have that with these 2. So these are not the same column space. Now let's have a look at the null space. Of course, I do have to have a vector in the null space because my rank was 2. I have 3 columns, so I have to have a nullity of 1. And there we can see I do have a vector in the null space. By the way, let's do this. You can do that with any of the others before. And now let's just do an elementary row operations on this vector and then call the null space. And you see nothing's changed. That's still the same basis vector. So the null space doesn't change. And in the next section, we'll see that the row space doesn't change, but the column space definitely changes in most cases, only in those special cases that it won't change. So as before, we're going to end off with a little proof. We have to show that this column space is a vector space. So for any matrix A that is the shape M times N, the column space is a subspace of Rm because there's m rows and my result vector will always be a m by 1. And we know that Rm is a vector space. You know, if once you've learned about vector spaces, you can show that Rm has all those properties of a vector space. They're all fulfilled, all those properties when you look at Rm. So to show that the column space is a subspace, we have to show only three things: that the column space contains at least one vector, and remember there's always the zero vector, even though that doesn't span a space, there is still a vector there. More importantly, we should talk about addition that holds and scalar multiplication that holds. So we know that we can always find the solution x equals zero for the homogeneous system b equals zero. That's what I said. So there's always that zero vector b. Now we want to know that if b sub 1 and b sub 2 are in the column space of A, we must have that b sub 1 plus b sub 2 is also in the column space of A. So that's easy enough to prove, because by our statement, ax sub 1 equals b sub 1 and ax sub 2 equals b sub 2, we've stated that both of those are in the column space. So we can write these two, and then we just do the addition ax sub 1 plus ax sub 2, that must equal b sub 1 plus b sub 2. And we know that we can rewrite the left-hand side as a times x sub 1 plus x sub 2. The right-hand side is going to be a new vector. But as we write it there, this new vector b sub 1 plus b sub 2 is in the column space of A, because the way that we can write it there. And then the same for the scalar multiple C, which is an element of the real numbers. So if I multiply left, multiply both sides by this scalar C, and by definition, we still have that b is in this column space, so we can write ax equals b. And then we just rewrite cax as a times cx from the properties of matrix vector multiplication, and that's going to equal this new vector cb, so cb is also in the column space. So we've shown that this row space is a vector subspace. It is a vector space, and it's a subspace of Rm in these examples that we've looked at. So I hope you learned something from this video on the column space. Remember, it's all about the result vector B. That's what the column space is about. You've learned that once you do elementary row operations, you're going to get a different column space unless you have a special case. And you can now clearly see, at least as far as the square matrices are concerned, if you have linear dependence, why you can't have an inverse, why you'll have a determinant of zero, because it's this idea of translating our matrix X into this column space B, and that there will be more than one vector that can go to the same column B. And then that means if you want to do an inverse, you know, which one of those two are you going to go to? So you can't really, it's a clear way to see why you won't have an inverse. In the next video, we're going to look at the row space of a matrix.